Assalamu alaikum. Welcome to the American Islamic College. Really appreciate that you all came out on this kind of foggy, quickly dropping temperature day. This is one of the first events organized by students here at the American Islamic College. Myself, I'm Bill Chambers. It should be good if I introduce myself. I'm also on the panel, but I'm a graduate student here in Islamic studies, and I focus on Islam and global studies. And one of my partners here, Tauseef Akbar, at the end, is also a graduate student here at the college. Wanted to say a couple things. The American Islamic College has been around for a little while now, and we offer bachelor's degrees and master's degrees in Islamic studies with either a focus on Islamic theology or Islam and global studies. We also offer a master's degree in Doctor of Divinity. So think of that path if you you want to be an imam, a community leader, a chaplain. That's what we look at for that type of program. One of the things that's important for us to mention is that all of our students that qualify to come here all receive free tuition scholarships. So we have a very, very diverse group of students. And to be blunt, even from my point of view, it's really a wonderful environment. Very warm, rigorously academic, but still in a very, very positive way. We have our president here. President Dawood Kaiswit is over there in the corner. And there's some information about the college in the brochures in the back if you're interested in finding out more about us, or even if you want to come back sometime for a tour. As you probably noticed, the very old building, the other building, not so sure about this one, but is on the historic registry. And we have quite a beautiful auditorium and classrooms and other things in the other building. And then lastly, you'll notice on your chairs, there's a couple things. One is we're very interested in getting your feedback. The college offers a lot of different events. This is the first student-oriented event that we're doing in conjunction with the Muslim Media Collaborative that Aymen here is in charge of, but we have many, many more lectures and that type of thing here for the community. So we're always interested in what you think about the programs we offer, maybe what programs we should offer. So when, you know, before you leave and you get a chance, you know, just fill that out at the end. The other thing is there's a small card there. All of our events here are free. But we always look for, you know, donations. If you'd like to donate something, there should be a box on the table back there when you leave. And like I said, you know, some of it has to do with we do want to be able to keep offering the free scholarships that we do for all of our students, whether they're bachelor students or master students. Okay, so on given that, I want to turn things over to Leena, our moderator for today, and then she'll go through introducing everybody. All right?
Assalamu alaikum, everyone. Thank you so much for coming out to this really important event and discussion. Like Bill said, my name is Leena Saleh. I am a communications manager with the Chicago Alliance Against Sexual Exploitation. We are a local nonprofit that serves survivors of prostitution and sexual assault. And I'd like to introduce the Muslim Media Collective, which is the organization that is launching this event and hosting it. So the Muslim Media Collective, it was founded and led by Chicago-based media educator and professional Aymen Abdel Halim. The Muslim Media Collective is a group of media educators and professionals advancing media education by providing customized media and digital literacy workshops and programs with the intention of empowering people of all ages with the skills needed to effectively navigate an increasingly ubiquitous and evolving media landscape. So I'm actually going to ask each of you to pull out your cell phones, and if you have Facebook, to please look up Muslim Media Collective and actually like the Facebook page. That way you'll be kept up to date with all of their events, programs, and they also share really great articles related to media education and literacy. So if everyone could just take a moment to do that now, I'd really appreciate it.
Are you on
Yes. Is it, what's the?
MMC Chicago.
Okay, so the Twitter tag is MMC Chicago. MuslimMediaCollective.org. And can people subscribe?
Yeah, you can subscribe to the news.
Okay, so yeah, if you go to MuslimMediaCollective.org, you can also subscribe to their emails to also be kept up to date through your email. So now that everybody's done that, I'd like to please ask you to silence your cell phones or turn them off for the remainder of the discussion and event. To introduce the why we're all here, so we're going to be discussing media and Islam in the time of Trump, a very important discussion within the Muslim community, but within the larger community as well. And we've brought together Chicago Muslim community media activists to present and discuss media and Islam in the time of Trump, with specifically how to challenge quote-unquote fake news and alternative facts. Without further ado, I'll introduce each of our speakers who are very distinguished and experienced activists in the community. So first up, we have Aymen Abdel Halim. He is the director of Muslim Media Collective and the communications director for CIOGC. As a media researcher and educator, Aymen Abdel Halim will discuss why media literacy is critical to navigating an increasingly ubiquitous and, again, evolving media landscape. And next, we have Bill Chambers. He is editor-in-chief of Chicago Monitor. By providing in-depth analysis of mainstream news, uncovering underreported and unreported stories, and challenging alternative facts, Bill Chambers will discuss how to fill that media gap that we see. We're also pleased to welcome Tahera Rahman. She is a news producer with Local 4 News, WHBF TV. With news reporting experience inside and outside of the Muslim community, Tahera offers unique insight and perspective on U.S. news reporting on Islam and Muslims. Last but not least, we have Tauseef Akbar, personal friend of mine and known him a long time, so hi Tauseef. he's a research coordinator at CAIR-Chicago, and as a researcher on Islamophobia, he has studied the Islamophobia industry and network and will discuss its influence and impact on media, government, and public life. Without any more delay, we'll just jump right into the first presentation, so please help me welcome Aymen.
Thank you, Leena, and thank you to the panelists. Thank you to everyone for attending. I really appreciate it. It's a really important discussion. Thank you to my son for attending for our first event as well. So I want to kind of just broadly talk about media literacy, media literacy issues across the board in the country right now. And I'm going to cite a Stanford study from fall of 2016. Included in the study were 8,000 students from lower resource classrooms in LA, as well as wealthier suburbs outside of Minneapolis. And some of those findings were really alarming, to say the very least. So more than 80% of the middle school students thought that sponsored content was a news story instead of an ad on slate.com. Also, across the board, students really struggled, according to the researchers, that they read only for content, but rarely do they consider where the information came from. Within that study as well, it showed that 225 high school students were shown two Facebook posts about Trump announcing his candidacy for presidency. One was from Fox News, the other was from Fox News, the Facebook page. And just so you know how it was actually written, it was Fox News-the FB page. Both of them included a Trump screenshot. So only 25% of those 225 high school students were able to recognize that one of the Facebook accounts, only one of the accounts was verified on Facebook. Now, how many of you are aware of verified pages on Facebook by a show of hands? Okay, that's good. So for those of you that aren't aware of verified pages, you're going to look for a blue circle with a check mark in it. Usually that validates the page as something legitimate, depending on what you see as legitimate, because there are also many issues in terms of what Facebook pages actually exist on the network. More than 30% of those students also thought the unverified page was more trustworthy because it included the screenshot of Trump's tweet. So when they were asked, so why did you think this one from the fake account was legitimate? And they said, well, they included a screenshot of the tweet. Now, how many of you know how to take a screenshot on your phone? Okay. how many of you know how to take a screenshot on your computer? That's a whole lot of you. So a lot of people can do that, right? It's not too hard. Within that study, also college students had trouble figuring out that minimumwage.com is actually managed by lobbyists for the food and beverage industry. So this was actually over 60% of college students that weren't able to kind of dig into that website a little bit more to find out that it was actually managed by lobbyists. In a Pew Research study that came out recently, 23% of Americans say they've shared a made-up or fake news story, either knowingly or not. 64% of Americans in that same study say fake news has caused a great deal of confusion about basic facts on current events. So I'm going to dive right into these issues on the web and how fake news gets constructed and disseminated. I'm going to give you a prime example. This is coming from a BuzzFeed News study about a group called American News LLC, which owns both a group of both liberal and conservative websites. So with just a few changes in their articles, they're able to appeal to distinctly different mass audiences. I'm going to give you an example. All right, so check out those headlines there and see, can someone tell me what was changed? The same organization or same company owns these sites. Right, so which one's appealing to what? So you see liberal society, very clear, like as to who they're speaking to. Conservative 101, very basic right there. Change a couple of words, you're speaking to two distinctly mass audiences, let alone the fact that there are problems within the article itself. Its validity itself is questioned. Let me show you.
Another one. Over recent months, Conway has been the go-to personality speaking on television for Trump, but the networks have banned her from their shows because her comments did not match the administration's official message. That's from Liberal Society. Conservative 101 says, over recent months, Conway has been the go-to personality speaking on TV for Trump, but the mainstream liberal media networks have banned her from their shows, claiming that her comments did not match the administration's official message. So just literally a couple of words and that's that. And so they own several sites on which they publish this information. Another site that they own is called American News. It has almost over 5 million Facebook fans. And so it actually put out this post last year during the campaign, and it said that Denzel Washington had endorsed Trump. Do you see how many likes? I know it's really hard to see. I'll tell you, over 42,000 likes, and that was within 6 hours of the post being published. Over 42,000, and again, they have a base of over 5 million Facebook fans. And no, Denzel Washington, in fact, did not endorse Trump. Google has actually been, so it's not just sites like this, but Google has actually been accused of spreading fake news because as part of their algorithms, depending on what you're searching for, apparently falsehoods and conspiracy theories have actually made their way to people's minds, essentially. So featured in their featured snippet search functionality, a lot of these types of sites and misinformation sites come up, and people are presented that information as legitimate sources. So the algorithm that Google uses does not recognize, or did not have to previously, wasn't that much of a problem previously, did not have to recognize fake news. It did not have to validate that information necessarily before it was presented to the public. But there are groups, there are media companies right now that are working on that issue. Facebook, in fact, has just introduced a fact-checking function so that when you paste an article into that status box, a warning pops up. It could be a fake news piece. A warning pops up that says disputed by Snopes.com and the Associated Press. Another issue that we see is that a lot of satire is out there, and it's being misread, very interestingly. So someone out there set up a website, and he wanted to do this experiment where he put out fake news and wanted to see if he could get a reaction from Trump fans. And he did. So he said, to my surprise, the Trump masses embraced my stories.
as fact, almost universally, it seemed that there wasn't anything I could write that was too wild or outrageous to be believed by this particular audience. While writing them, I was aiming for stories that no one would believe, but rather would be satirical in an age where disinformation is so prevalent. Just for fun, I decided to post some of the stories in Trump fan groups on Facebook just to see reactions. One fake story headlined WikiLeaks, Obama ran pedophile ring out of White House, amassed more than 40,000 views. So the top comment reads, I believe it, they're scum. Down with the Obamas. He and his wife took $111 million worth of stuff that should be repaid to the taxpayers. Back to America. Another commenter said, I'm impressed by how this website tells it like it is. No sensationalism at all. Straight facts. Straight facts and well-documented research with sources and all. Thank God for the alternative media that saves us from the mainstream garbage by showing us the truth. Now, I thought to myself, okay, that could be someone who's actually believing what this person is publishing, but it also could be a satirical comment. I don't know, maybe they're actually reading it in the way that this person was intending, in that satirical way. So we don't know. Fact is, you just need to look up where this information is coming from, right? I want to go through some Breitbart headlines next. Hillary Clinton's Muslim Brotherhood problem.
Political. These are all Breitbart headlines. Political correctness protects Muslim rape culture. Don't want to miss them. Huffington Post, scores for the hijab. Pamela Geller. Again, this is a platform for a lot of anti-Muslim propagandists out there that are part of a well-documented Islamophobia network that Brother Tauseef will probably touch on a little bit later. Pamela Geller, immediately after Muslim mayor elected, London's iconic buses proclaimed glory to Allah. This has nothing to do with the mayor. This is an ad from Islamic Relief, one of the most charitable organizations in the world. Silicon Valley startup culture explains why mass Muslim immigration must stop. Man bites dog, Muslim is nice to non-Muslim. These are real headlines. Six reasons Pamela Geller's Muhammad cartoon contest is no different from Selma. She's comparing herself to MLK, saying this is a quest for justice. Pamela Geller, how Muslim migrants devastate a community. Bill Kristol, Republican spoiler, renegade Jew. So they're even attacking, you know, they are destroying or attempting to destroy the livelihoods and careers of individuals that they are just not, they don't agree with politically. There's no hiring bias against women in tech, they just suck at interviews. Why equality and diversity departments should only hire rich, straight white men. Science proves it, fat shaming works. The solution to online harassment is simple, women should log off. These are real. And what's even more frightening is to show you the impact this website had in the past year during the election. So Breitbart grew in its power in the past year. As some of you might know, Steve Bannon was the campaign manager of Trump's campaign for presidency, and Bannon is also the founder of Breitbart. So he stayed very much connected. In fact, Breitbart served as a platform for much of Trump's rhetoric, essentially. You see here, Fox News, I have to mention this, Fox News was, they started to kind of take stabs or jabs at Breitbart early in 2016. Breitbart bit back, so much so that Fox News backed off because they were that vicious. You saw those headlines. Fox News actually backed off and let Breitbart do their thing. And you'll see here, Fox News right here, this is Breitbart, and then this is from February, in February 2016. This is after Breitbart attacked Fox News and just how much they grew. So you see how much influence they have, just as much almost as the New York Times, more than Washington Post, CNN, or The Hill even.
I'm not going to go through a repeat of a lot of the rhetoric that Trump had has made about Muslims during his campaign. Many of you are aware of that. But I want to jump right into how corporate media and the fairness for accuracy in reporting are arguing that how corporate media have paved the way for Trump's Muslim ban. So they said that surveys had found support for Trump's ban ranging from 42 to 47%, and that this is in line with 43% of Americans willing to admit to having at least some prejudice against Muslims. So we must say that it hasn't happened. They say this has happened within the past 15 years, and I would argue against that to say it's been happening for more than a century at least, or I would even argue further than that to say the beginning of Islam. Many people believe that the first victim of Islamophobia is the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. So when you think back all the way to then to now and how that type of perception has developed over time, but yes, of course, within the past 15 years, it's become much worse. So in the week after Trump signed the Muslim ban, primetime cable news programs hosted 176 guests. Some were repeat, but only 14 of those 176 were actually Muslims. So now the question comes, there are more than 3 million Muslims in America, right? And there are many, many Muslim groups, and there are many speakers, and many authors and scholars, et cetera, down the line. Now, who is it that's being selected, and what are they saying, and why? Those questions have to be asked. But why 14 out of 176? We're talking about something that affects Muslims directly. Georgia State University. U.S. media outlets disproportionately emphasize the smaller of terror attacks by people claiming to be Muslim, which leads Americans to have an exaggerated sense of threat. So over 90% of the terrorist acts that happen on domestic soil are committed by right-wing extremists, and this is documented by the FBI. Muslims make up a tiny, tiny number. People who claim to be Muslim make up a tiny number, smaller than you would even think like green activists, you know. So with this rise of anti-Islamophobic rhetoric or anti-Muslim rhetoric, we've also seen at the same time hate crimes start to rise. So a Georgetown study on Islamophobia in the 2016 elections said that as Trump called for shutting down mosques in the wake of the Paris attacks and mass shootings in San Bernardino in December 2015, anti-Muslim attacks initially tripled within nearly half of those attacks were directed at mosques. Right now, one in three Muslims fear for their safety during the Trump presidency. And this coincides with the fact that media have freely admitted that Trump has made them a lot of money. Just last year during the campaign, the CEO of CBS, Les Moonves, said, "It may not be good for America, but it's damn good for CBS." And he's referring to, again, Trump's campaign. Now we understand he brings a lot of attention, and this is why he earned a lot of free media coverage as well. He earned over $1.9 billion in free media coverage versus Clinton's $746 million. And so he really didn't have to pay for much. He just got the attention because of a lot of what he was doing. And it gave, you know, there were a lot of good ratings around that, and that brought those profits in. So with that said, I think that's pretty much everything. And I would say, you know, in the face of these issues, it's really important to diversify your news consumption, to check your sources, to check if the information you're looking at is verified, if it's reputable. And again, come to your own decision. I think a lot of the time, for example, the Columbia Journalism Review said, I like this term that they use. They say, we're looking for the daily me. And as you see from these, so much of our news is so insular. We go back to these specific sources and we need to diversify. We're getting our information in bubbles, and that becomes very dangerous because it narrows your worldview. So that would be my recommendation in the face of all of this. And again, thank you guys so much.
since Leena already introduced me, I don't think I need to be introduced again. Again, if you've forgotten already, I'm Bill Chambers. I'm the editor-in-chief of the Chicago Monitor. One of my favorite hadiths or saying of the Prophet Muhammad is the one that says that the best jihad is a word of justice to an unjust ruler. And if you notice, one of the things that sounds very familiar to is the term that you hear a lot of speaking truth to power. Now, if you listen to that, it's more than speaking truth. It's speaking that word of justice, which means taking some action. So the way we look at it at the Chicago Monitor, we look at the Chicago Monitor as our word of justice. And that unjust ruler right now is Trump, is considered as the U.S. government. But it's also, there's certainly been plenty of injustice that has gone on for many years and many other administrations. So when we talk about, and I want to give you a little bit of background on the Chicago Monitor. Chicago Monitor was founded by the executive director of CARE, Ahmed Rehab, which I know some of you know. And his original intention was, and this is where the word monitor comes from, was to take a look at mainstream media and see how they presented Islam, they presented Muslims, and as Aymen has already talked about, this presentation has been very negative and so on. So that was the original intention. But the last 3 years or so, the Chicago Monitor has really turned into a platform to look at social justice, human rights issues. From what perspective? A Muslim perspective. But when you think of it, the Muslim perspective we're talking about here is a perspective of social justice. So looking at those stories that aren't being covered, those occurrences of injustice in the world that the mainstream media or just the media in general is not looking at for many reasons. And we'll go into some background about that. The thing I want to emphasize, though, is all the editors of the Chicago Monitor are Muslims. We got a managing editor, I'm the editor-in-chief, I'm an assistant editor, are all Muslims. But that doesn't mean it's Muslim news. A lot of our community that reads the paper is the Muslim community, but there are many, many people that read our online news service. In fact, I did a rather interesting count. I really had no idea how this would turn out. I was really curious, out of all the different contributors we've had over the years, how many were Muslims and how many were non-Muslims? Very oddly enough, it was equal. There were 80 Muslim contributors and 80 non-Muslim contributors. So if you think about that for a minute, the other thing to think about is, I also was curious, since this there's a lot of Muslim readers here and Muslim writers and contributors, what does the gender breakdown look like? Well, actually, two-thirds of our contributors are women and one-third are men. So that's another kind of statement. If you want to think of it as value-lated, that is value-lated, and that's an important kind of issue. So the way we look at it is, this is news that's managed and directed by Muslims, but again, it's not Muslim news. It's of interest to many, many other people. So one of the things that I wanted to talk about is, as I said, the Chicago Monitor focuses on news that isn't covered by the community of broadcasters and media, no matter what type you're talking about. And of course, we do cover issues that are of concern for the Muslim community. So one good example is the war on Yemen. Now, I'd be curious, when was the last time anybody read an article about the war on Yemen? Okay, it's been going on for at least 2 years. The Chicago Monitor has done multiple articles on the war on Yemen since the beginning. One of the articles we did we interviewed Yemeni families who were trying to get their loved ones out of Yemen. And some of those people were U.S. citizens. Not to go into the details, but what we found out was at the very beginning of the war, the U.S. State Department shut down the embassy and left. So you would think the U.S. would have attempted to evacuate their own citizens. I mean, this is a very, very dangerous time. And on the State Department website, and this was the same thing some of these families we interviewed were told, well, no, we're really not providing, we don't feel it safe. We're really not providing any evacuation, but we understand that there are ships from India and China and Somalia that are evacuating their citizens from Yemen. So if you go to the port at Aden, maybe you can get on one of those ships. I mean, this was literally what they said. Was that reported in the news anywhere? No. Very recently, how many of you would say you've read a story about the refugee crisis in Yemen? Okay, good. Where did you read that? Remember where you read it?
On the internet.
Okay. Yeah, the very last article that we did on Yemen was looking at this. There's a huge refugee crisis, and most of the media, rightfully so, focuses on Syria or immigrants coming to the United States or in Europe or so on. But there is 2.8 million displaced people in Yemen. And the UN has talked about over 14 million people are what they term food insecure, which means they're starving. Is there much of this in the news? No. Why would that be? Well, you know, some of the analysis that we do kind of thinks, well, let's see, Yemen, were they on the list of the countries that aren't being allowed immigrants here? Yeah. Are there terrorists in Yemen? Yeah. So there's some background or political issue that's going on about why this isn't being covered. Another area that my friend Tauseef here has covered quite a bit is the Rohingya. The Muslims that are in Burma or Myanmar, that a genocide has been going on there for a very long time, and in fact, it's increased. And this is something that we as the Chicago Monitor has been trying to get out to the Muslim community. You know, they're Muslims, you know, you think people would care. Or even the general community. Very little about it in the news. Tauseef covered, there was a People's Tribunal in the UK, right, I believe? Yeah. And they had a whole presented evidence, and they ended up indicting the Myanmar leaders for genocide and atrocities. But again, Myanmar is a state that the U.S. supports, and their leaders, they're moving towards democracy. Well, they're also moving towards genocide, and no one is doing much about it. So that's another example. There's political issues here about why that's not being covered. One of the more important ones that we got a tremendous amount of hits on the website. Has anybody heard, does anybody know who Ben Keita is? Does the name sound familiar? Anybody remember the story of in January, a Muslim teen that was found hung out in the woods north of Seattle? Anybody heard about that? Okay. That happened in early January. He disappeared. His parents, they said, well, no, he wasn't depressed. They don't know what happened. He was found out in the woods hung. They initially did a coroner report, said it was suicide, and they said, no, we don't think so. And the FBI, with push from CAIR in the area, got kind of interested and so on. But they said, well, we don't have enough evidence that there's anything untoward that happened, which means, you know, they don't know what happened. There was no coverage anywhere in the news about that. So one of our interns, Amal Ahmed, she's a journalism student at Northwestern, wrote this article. A black Muslim teen was found hung from a tree and no one notices. This was early in March. We had 500,000 hits on that article. I mean, our typical hits is, you know, 2,500. We're a small organization. But that's a good example. Like, why wasn't that covered? That same month, there were six Muslims who were gunned down in a mosque in Quebec City by a self-professed Trump supporter. Well, that was kind of covered, but this black Muslim teen, no one cared. And this article, Amal talked about lynching. You know, that's one of the things you kind of think about. You know, a black Muslim teen, they're found in the woods. You know, it brings you back to a period of time in the South that the lynching went on. Wasn't discussed, wasn't brought up or anything. So the other thing I want to shift to is talking a little bit about, so those are topics that obviously are of interest to the Muslim community, but they're also interest to people that are human beings and care about social justice and human rights and those kinds of things. Well, let's move to general social justice issues that are very important and that are of interest to the general community. And Aymen talked about this whole idea of alternative facts, one of our taglines, and it's the Chicago Monitor taglines, is just because we want to, you know, get on the bandwagon and get people's attention, is we challenge alternative facts. Well, alternative facts have been going on a very long time. I'm wondering, does anybody remember the weapons of mass destruction that were in Iraq? Okay. I mean, this has been happening a long time. What's happening now is it's absolutely in the mainstream. Even when it's challenged, the president still says it anyway. But this kind of thing has been going on a very long time. And the thing to remember is that there's always a reason why it's not being covered. There's some other agenda going on. So I want to start this section just with a quote. Maybe some of you might recognize who this is. My vision of social justice is predicated upon two things: my personal experience of inequities because of race, class, and gender, and my search in the Islamic tradition, and more precisely in the Quranic text, for a perspective on civil society which dispels the tendency towards oppression and social injustice. Any of my Muslim scholars know who this is? Okay, it's Amina Wadood. Amina Wadood is a African-American Muslim scholar of the Quran. And as you notice, one of the things that she primarily focuses on, which I do as a Muslim, and I think the Chicago Monitor does, is this whole idea of social justice and how that comes out of our religion. And also, she talks about race, class, and gender. Those are all very important issues when you're talking about injustice. So one of the other big social justice stories is the Black Lives Matter movement. Major movement going on in the city and so on. I'm curious if there was a march in Chicago, this would have been in August of 2015, very large march, like 3,000 people. It was led by the Black Lives Matter movement. Anybody here remember that? Was here? Yeah. Do you know what was the goal of that march? Do you have any idea? And if you don't know, there's a good reason that you don't know. But okay, the reason you don't know is that that particular march, and in fact to mention, it was also endorsed by the CIOGC, which you were there at the time, I think, maybe before. Yeah. So it was endorsed by the whole Council on Islamic Organizations in Greater Chicago, large Muslim contingent, as there was a Latino and a Latinx contingent and so on. And if you read the newspapers or the media, you'd have no idea. This was a Black Lives Matter march and all these different groups. That march was for an elected board, a community control of the police board. That was the entire purpose of that march. And in fact, the leaders from the Black Lives Matter movement and the Chicago Alliance Against Racism and Political Repression have developed a ordinance that now actually did get presented in the city council for an elected civilian police review board that was not underneath and in control of Mayor Emanuel. They would look at police crimes and all that. That was all over the march, and that's what we in the Chicago Monitor wrote about. This is what this is about. If you looked at the media, the idea was, Black Lives Matter, it's like another Occupy Wall Street movement, you know, all these people, yeah, they have some points, but they really don't have any demands. That's how it was presented. No, there was an exact demand, and there was an exact approach for getting that demand implemented. Why didn't they want people to hear that? Well, they didn't want people to hear that. They want the review board to be still under Rahm Emanuel's control. The other thing about that, if you notice, large number of Muslims turned out. Was that a Muslim community issue? Well, for many people in the community, absolutely is an issue. But that's another example of, if you're, from our point of view, if you're the Muslim media, or you're a Muslim in the media, or like the Chicago Monitor, that doesn't mean you only cover issues that either are of concern to the Muslim issue or have something to do with Islamophobia or whatever. You cover all these other issues, but from the point of view of our values, our social justice values, okay? So the last one I want to point out is this article that's up there. It was one of mine. So if you go out to Chicago, this is chicagomonitor.com. So if you go out there, this was just published a couple days ago, and you can see what the title is. The Jewish United Fund is it's a very good social service agency. Does a lot of good work for the Jewish community and other communities locally, and the national group does over the country. They also are very big advocates for the state of Israel. The Jewish Voice for Peace, who actually has their convention here coming up, there's like 1,000 people coming here in Chicago. They did a report and found out that between 2011 and 2014. There were 700,000 donations from groups that the Southern Poverty Law Center calls anti-Muslim hate groups to the Jewish United Fund, $700,000 worth. So when Aymen was talking about that a little while ago, people like Daniel Pipes, you heard of, Steve Emerson, if you go to the Southern Poverty Law Center, these are like some of the worst of the worst. The other interesting thing, just like Breitbart News, they're also anti-Semitic. So many of the anti-Muslim groups are also very anti-Semitic. So you ask yourself, well, why is the Jewish United Fund taking money from them? So the Jewish activists here are saying, you need to return this money and you need to disavow these groups. The other part of this is, when Steve Bannon, who Aymen mentioned, was nominated as the National Security Advisor for the Trump administration, we've already kind of talked about Steve Bannon ran Breitbart News. He ran all those anti-Muslim, anti-Semitic articles. He was like in charge of it. So you would think some of these organizations, like the Jewish United Fund, would say something. The only thing they said was, well, I think we ought to give President Trump's administration a chance. A chance? What, you haven't been paying attention for the last couple years? So why is that? And then you start to have to ask, and it's not like a conspiracy here, that in some cases, and again, this would be our theory, that your support in this case, maybe for the state of Israel, is for whatever reason overcoming your attack on anti-Semitism. Maybe, that's one theory, but at least you shouldn't be accepting this kind of money. So that's the kind of thing that, to summarize that point, that if we look at alternative news, and this is like in a time of Trump, you kind of look at this type of story and go, okay, what's the basis of the story is usually, Jewish United Fund, they do all these good things. And, well, in this case, there is a connection here with the Islamophobia that's in the Trump administration. And back when I did one article, this was beginning of last year, it was called Islamophobia Has Gone Mainstream. Which I think it has during the political campaign. Well, now I would say, I mean, Islamophobia is part of the administration. I mean, there's a whole number of figures that are part of that. One of the things I just wanted to end on was, I always like quotes, so I'll see if you know who this is. Another, I don't need to talk about that. I'm a Muslim, but I know it's not in the mosque that we will win. It's in the streets, in the cities, side by side with those who, whites included, want to rid the country of the racism that is eating it away. Anybody want to take a guess who that is? Somebody has to know. It's Malcolm X. Okay? So, very important in terms of the first thing he says, I am a Muslim. And this was his speech when he was invited to the Oxford Union. So he was assassinated a few months later. But his whole point was, I'm a Muslim and change is not going to happen in the mosque. Going to the mosque is important. It's not going to just happen there. And it's going to happen out in the streets. And to do a little expansion of his words, it's not just out in the streets and protests. It's out doing these kind of panels. It's writing articles about Islamophobia. It's writing to the letters to the editor. It's all those types of things. And that's how you attack racism, again, just like the Black Lives Matter movement, which is one of the major issues in America right now. So I'm going to finish with that, and hopefully you'll have questions later. Okay.
All right, assalamualaikum again, I'm Tahera. I work with CBS 4, that is the local CBS station in the Quad Cities, so that's the Illinois-Iowa border, four or five different cities on each side, on both sides of the river on the Mississippi there. So, having said that, I've seen my fair share of both sides of the coin when it comes to being the producer of Radio Islam within Islamic media, as well as being a Muslim journalist in the larger context of media in general, mainstream media, as you would call it. So I do have some points that I'd like to make, and I definitely want to focus more, though, on action items for all of us to be able to take forward. So I'm hoping to kind of skim through a couple of these points and then get to the meat and bones of those action items. So I think one of the best things, and this is probably, I say this with a little bit of like sadness in my heart, but I think one of the best things to come out of so far the Trump era is actually the media. I think there is a sense in the journalism community, even not in the Muslim journalist community, but in general, a kind of sense of guilt or of taking some of that blame for feeding into the media frenzy surrounding President Donald Trump's campaign. And I think we all know how that played out. For us, we saw that with a look of horror in our eyes, right? Every other day, multiple times a day, he would say something, and bam, 2 seconds later, he was front and center in the news. And that, as Aymen pointed out, was free PR for him. And it just kind of rolled and snowballed, and next thing we knew, we were watching the poll numbers come in on election night, and we're like, this is happening. And I think that there was, and still is, a sense of, okay, well, we fed into that frenzy as journalists, as gatekeepers of information. We weren't doing a good job of fact-checking and pushing back during the presidential campaign. And so I think right now, a lot of it is that a lot of the good part of the media right now is that we are on the default defensive. So now when you see, for example, the first travel ban, he came out with that executive order, and within minutes, there was pushback in the media. Even in the mainstream media, there's kind of an explanation of, all right, so people are banned from traveling into the US from these 10 Muslim majority countries, followed up with, at least in the CBS angle, followed up with, but many people, all terrorist attacks that happen in the U.S. none of them are from that list of countries that are banned. It doesn't make sense, essentially. So I think that was one good thing. And to Eamon's point, there is still a huge gap as far as who those people are disseminating that information. Ideally, there would be more Muslims in that framework being able to speak on those issues, but I think it is a good start. And that pushback, I think, has gotten us to, and it's hard to say, it's hard to look at the little rays of sunshine, but it's gotten to us to a pretty good place as of right now. On Friday, for example, we had reported that there's a new Quinnipiac poll that showed that 60% of Americans, 60% see President Trump as dishonest. And that's great, like great for us. You know, that means that all the work the activists are doing to push back on every single piece of legislation or every single press conference that he comes out with, that's having an impact on the larger American public and the viewership. So I think that's something that we can take with us as we move forward. And going off of that Quinnipiac poll, it's not even just the general public, but 39% of Republicans don't believe his wiretapping claims. As we all know, he's claiming that President Obama wiretapped his presidential campaign from Trump Tower. So 39% of Republicans don't even believe that. And that's great for us. That's great news for us who are in the media or even in the general public who care about the truth coming out. So I think now what it comes down to as far as media responsibility as a Muslim journalist for me is making sure that those facts do get out. On a daily basis, even for smaller, what seemingly small stories. And along with that comes putting things into context. So one example, recent example, is the rise of bomb threats at the Jewish community centers across the nation. That was a huge story for probably a week straight. And it's something that we reported on too at CBS. But as a Muslim woman, that was doubly concerning to me because not only is it an attack on one religious group, but I knew from personal experience, from the Facebook articles, from anecdotal experience, that this was happening to Muslim community centers too. And that concerned me because that part of the narrative wasn't getting out there. And I knew it was happening, but there was no like comprehensive PR press conference saying this is an attack on our community. We've had X number of attacks since just January, and this, you know, there was no kind of cohesive response as a Muslim community on our end. And that got me thinking, and that is something that that is part of the reason why I think there needs to be a bigger push with media engagement and media involvement within the Muslim community, because I have a responsibility, I have a media responsibility, but I can't do it, we can't do it without you guys. And I think that's mostly what I wanted to focus on. So what I tried to do, for example, is when I started reporting those stories, the Jewish cemetery vandalism, another bomb threat at one Jewish community center in X state, I would follow that up with the latest piece of information I had from CNN, for example. Even though there were smaller articles, there wasn't a full story on it, I would just pull that information and add it to my script for my anchors to read, saying, for example, one of the scripts I added to was that other religious communities are also seeing a rise in hate crimes. Just this morning, the FBI in Florida is investigating a case of arson and potential hate crime in, I think it was in Tampa Bay, Florida. And my uncle had sent me that article because it was his mosque. And so I knew that it was out there, and I weave that into the larger story of hate crimes because I didn't want it to become very segmentative and selective. So going along with that, I think one of the most common challenges a Muslim reporter, a Muslim journalist faces oftentimes within the Muslim community is kind of a by default cynical view of the media, which makes sense if you think about it. I mean, post 9/11 coverage of Muslims was very bad. It was, to use Trump's words, it was very bad. It was bigly bad. So we had we had all this negative coverage on both ends, right? So we were the suspects and we were also the victims of hate crimes. I remember going into school in elementary school. I went to Universal School in Bridgeview. And there were cops surrounding our school for like the next 2 weeks because we had gotten so many threats. And we had been in the community for decades, but that didn't matter at that point because the media, it felt like there was a media assault on the Muslim community. And so it makes sense then coming out of that, that people are apprehensive about talking to the media and talking about their narratives. But I think that needs to change. And the media has evolved. Our situation politically and socioeconomically has evolved. And so have we as Muslim Americans. We don't only care about, as Bill Chambers was saying, we don't care about just, or we shouldn't, about just the issues that affect Muslims or Muslim issues or Islamophobia. This is about all of us now. The Trump era and media in the Trump era is not just about Islamophobia. It's about, you know, everyone who is not in the white community feeling threatened. It's about Latino Americans. It's about African Americans. It's about LGBTQ community in the U.S. at this time. So I think taking that into mind, it would be really helpful for the movement in general if you kind of look for those opportunities. Look for the opportunities to argue and make a point for what you stand for, because your empty narrative is going to be filled with someone else's story. That's just the case. And one example I want to bring up to this is, I've always had a passion for reporting. And so that's what I did in college, and that's what I plan to do even in the TV industry, God willing. And so I go out, I'm putting in hours over the weekend, I go with reporters and help them with their stories, besides my producing job, 9 to 5 or whatever during the week. And after the first executive order came out on the travel ban, I was with a reporter in the Quad Cities, and she was covering that, kind of the local effect on the Muslim community after that news came out. I was really glad I was there because I was able to kind of minimize the damage, but she was calling around to different sources that we have in the Quad Cities, Muslim sources, and one brother got very offended that she called him. And she basically said, I'm working on the story, and she's a reporter of color, so she's very sensitive to the fact that our voices are often underreported, and she's making an extra effort to make sure she covers all her bases. So she calls this brother in the Muslim community, and I could hear him on the other end of the phone, and he just goes off. He's like, does this ban affect you? Is it gonna affect you? And she said, I don't have anyone, I don't have any relatives in the Middle East. He's like, well, it doesn't affect me either. I'm an American citizen just like you, and I'm not gonna speak about this because it doesn't affect me, and I'm just like you. And he just hangs up. And I get that he is, oftentimes, sometimes we feel overwhelmed. Being the only Muslim in the newsroom for the last probably 7 years at different newsrooms across, you know, the Midwest, I get that too. Sometimes you feel like you have so much to cover, you're just one person, you don't want to say anything wrong. There's a lot of pressure there. But if that's the case, you can always refer them to somebody else who is willing to speak. Because I think if I weren't there, her face fell. She didn't want to cover the story anymore. That was your chance to get our narrative out, and it could have been lost. She could have gone to somebody else, like Aymen said, who wasn't a Muslim and who claims to be an expert on this topic. So I think that that's one thing we need to keep in mind is if you do feel like that, that's okay. It's okay to feel overwhelmed and not want to be a spokesperson for the Muslim community. But I think you need to be ready to at least approach that in a way where you're not putting other people off, and we can still get our narrative out there, whether it's not through you, through someone else. So I think that's the biggest thing for me. And then just a couple of other things that I've noticed as being a producer is, to get your narrative out is to not be afraid to reach out to your local media. I know a lot of times people think that getting your voice out might mean you have to be protesting on the streets, you have to cause a commotion to be able to get the media's attention. But you really don't, especially when it comes to local media. Your local stations, obviously if you want to be on the CBS Evening News with Scott Pelley, that's going to take a lot more work. But if you are on your local CBS station or ABC station, you reach out to the news director, you reach out to a reporter, you reach out to a producer. I'm always checking my emails as a producer and looking for story ideas to send our reporters to. That's just an easy way. Any event you have, literally anything, even if it's not political, even if it's something nice, a lot of times we look for those nice stories and it humanizes the community. And so one example of that was on Eid last year. It was my first Eid in the Quad Cities. And I knew that they were having a picnic for Muslim women and their children. And I thought, hey, that's a nice little story. Nobody knows what Eid is here. And I remember I slugged the story in my rundown for our news afternoon news meeting. And when people saw that, like Eid picnic, they're like, what's EID? What is this? And so, I mean, it's nice to be able to explain something not in a kind of heated context, you know, about religion. And it happens down the road. And so I think even though don't be afraid to just send out a press release, pick up the phone and call the news director or producer and say, hey, this is going on. I think it would be great. And then see what happens. And don't get discouraged if they don't send someone. You know, it just depends on the day sometimes and what else is going on. Just keep at it. Like, it's part of our duty as American Muslims. And just to remember that, you know, it may seem like the media is against you or against us sometimes, but we also want to get the truth out. Like, we're friends. We should all be friends. We may not know, there are journalists who may not know a lot about Islam or Muslims or different cultures and viewpoints that even are within the Muslim community, but it's something that is coming from a good place, and especially when someone's trying, I urge you to work with it because it will benefit everyone in the end. And I think that with those little tips, hopefully, that we can move forward and that 60% of Americans can go up to 80, 90, and who knows, maybe a change in the direction of our political history. So thank you.
Thank you again for having me here. It's wonderful. Being on a panel where you know everybody you've worked close with as well, you know, a lot of food for thought here. So yeah, once again, my name is Tauseef Akbar. I work with CAIR-Chicago. I help develop the research department there, you know, as far as what kind of topics we're gonna look into, analyze, discuss. And today, I'm going to, you know, a lot of the panelists have already discussed how the media has, you know, how it operates, how it works, which stories they're missing, which are underreported, action items to, you know, kind of affect change and to be part of, you know, this burgeoning, what I would call like a Muslim renaissance in terms of engagement. And so, first of all, I want to start off with talking about what Islamophobia is and is not. You know, it's not about, you know, you have to like the fact that Muslims don't eat bacon, or, you know, you don't have to worry about being Islamophobic if you like eating bacon. That's not what we're talking about, and most of you know that. Most people get that. But what Islamophobia actually is an ideological formation that facilitates American empire and promotes certain political and economic goals. And I want us to understand this point, that there is, this isn't just about isolated incidences of hate crimes or isolated incidences of bigotry, but in fact, there's a project going on. For instance, when we talk about Breitbart and the fact that the chief editor, one of the founders, Stephen Bannon, is actually chief advisor to Trump. This is not by happenstance. This is not just a coincidence. This is a political project. And so I would also want to draw your attention to Hope Not Hate is an organization. When you guys get a chance, look into their recent report. about Breitbart's attempt to replicate what they did in the United States within Europe. For instance, the Brexit, some of you may be familiar with, you know, before Trump got elected, there was this move in the UK where voters voted to leave the EU. You know, the EU has been a prosperous thing for Europe. It's been something that has unified it in many ways. And many people were scratching their heads here, pundits, like, why is the UK leaving the European Union? And in fact, Breitbart had a role to play there, as well as other right-wing media. Their chief editor in the UK, Rahim Kassam, who is part of this neocon wing of so-called ex-Muslim, Muslim reformers, he actually took on becoming the chief advisor to UKIP, to the United Kingdom Independence Party, which was one of the chief political parties that moved the propaganda within the UK and pushed other political parties further right and to capitalize on this effort to leave the EU. The UKIP wasn't successful in terms of how many votes they got, but their main goal, Breitbart's main goal of Brexit or leaving the EU was achieved. So that's just one thing to keep in mind, is the influence of these groups is not just something by coincidence. It is a serious political project that they're also trying to replicate. Now they have offices opened up in Germany and France, and those elections are coming up as well. And so getting back to this aspect, the two aspects of Islamophobia, being domestically and abroad. Abroad, you have the war on terror. You have these invasions of nations of Iraq and Afghanistan. You have the drone attacks, the drone warfare that we've all been accustomed to, and many of us are desensitized or don't know much about. And just a point of fact, 4 million Iraqis and Afghanis have died in these wars in the past 2 decades. You can go to Physicians for Social Responsibility. You can look at also the reports by Lancet. And this is not something that just started after 9/11, bear in mind. This began with the Gulf War. This terrorizing and destruction of the region. Now, the reason I bring this in and why does it tie in so intimately with the media and media's role, as well as how it relates to Islamophobia. So if you recall, in 2003, in the lead up to the Iraq War, you had polling done of Americans regarding their support of these wars. You had 75% of Americans who believed that Iraq was responsible for 9/11. Now, why is this the case? You know, Bill mentioned the whole propaganda about weapons of mass destruction. You know, there was the issue of the uranium and so forth, that, you know, this fictitious uranium that Iraq was fertilizing or what have you. And you know, the only way I feel that you can somehow conflate Iraq and Afghanistan, or Iraq and bin Laden, is to say, to think that all Muslims are the same. And you had a lead up to this war in which 9/11 and Iraq were serendipitously conflated consistently and with an unquestioning media. So when you talk about the media guilt, you know, there was even some of that after, you know, the stuff hit the fan in Iraq. But are we going to be able to capitalize in this present moment? It's still, you know, a wait and see type of thing. Quickly, domestically, you know, I'm just going to run through some of the major problematic issues that have come up as a result of the lack of media scrutiny, the lack of the critical eye, the intimate nature of the connection between media and the propagation of Islamophobia over the past few years. So you had the passage of the Patriot Act. You had NSEERS, which saw the upending of communities. I come from a community in Chicago, which was predominantly Indo-Pak, and you know, right there in Rogers Park, you know, not far from Devon Avenue, where many of you may have gone to, you know, get your biryani or what have you. And people I grew up with, who I played sandlot baseball with, or we hit the basketball courts at Warren Park, overnight, you know, the demand with NSEERS was that you would register with Naturalization Services, right? And overnight, these individuals, some of whom were undocumented, some of whom did not have citizenship, their lives were turned upside down. I have friends whose family sold property completely, you know, who had, for instance, cab medallions, which may have been worth, you know, 10 times more than what they sold it at. And they fled to Canada. Some who couldn't make it to Canada had to go back to tougher situations in Pakistan or India. And so this has real consequences. That's the point of what I'm trying to get at. You know, from NSEERS, you had increased surveillance of Muslim American communities. This wasn't just something that started now. It started in the Bush era, and even previously there was some of this. Masajid have been targeted with undercover agents. You've had community centers that have been infiltrated in this manner, restaurants and bodegas. Arun Kundanani, who's written a very excellent book that I would suggest everyone get a chance to look at or see a summary of, notes in his research that there are currently 15,000 spies, and he wrote this back in 2015, 15,000 FBI informants who are on the what you would call like the not, you know, the payroll of the FBI. We don't know the exact number that are within the Muslim community, but this number of 15,000 is more than what existed in the time of COINTELPRO, about several times more than what was, as far as informants and spies that existed in COINTELPRO in the 70s, which targeted black liberation movements, you know, brown liberation movements that were trying to uplift and better their communities, who were growing and were seen as a threat just because they were reaching a point of enfranchisement. Which brings me back to one of the dons of Islamophobia for the past several decades. Daniel Pipes has a famous quote where he was speaking at the AJC in 2001 and talking about the fear and the anxiety of the presence of Muslims, saying that the increased stature and affluence and enfranchisement of American Muslims presents a danger to American Jews, to non-Muslims. And so this is the logic that you're dealing with. It's a political project that wants to upend and put a halt to the growth and enfranchisement of an up-and-coming minority. We've seen it in the past where it's been done and it's continued to be done against other communities, black or brown, it doesn't matter. But now you see it hyper-visible with Muslims. Then you have CVE, which is used to be called Countering Violent Extremism, but all pretense to this being some sort of equal opportunity look at whatever violent, this polemical term of violent extremism. Now Trump is being obvious about it. You know, that's one good thing. You know, as Malcolm said, you know, I'd rather deal with the wolf who bears his teeth than hides it, where he is now calling it countering Islam, radical Islamic extremism. This is an actual program that the government is involved in, and it's based on a faulty framework, largely on a faulty framework of radicalization or analyzing radicalization taken up from the UK called PREVENT. So it's not based on any sort of real empirical evidence. It ties ideology to be the root cause of terrorism, And once again, if you think, put your political, view this from a political economic lens, you see that the purpose is that, you know, it obscures the fact that there are other root causes. You know, Muslims and Muslim leaders and allies have been screaming this from the beginning. You know, it's not about simply these ideologies or these political Muslim groups. This is about wars that have been continuous in the Muslim world, Muslim majority nations, for decades now. These are the root causes. You can look at the research by Robert Pape, you know, at the University of Chicago, spoken here at American Islamic College several times, presented his research on the reason why terrorism exists in the world today. One thing I want to tie in here as well is, you know, we have this discussion about the motives for why we see so much fake news or lies. Why are these lies propagated? You know, Tahera spoke about the fact that 60% of Americans see Trump as a liar, you know, and I'm curious if there was polling pre-election, how many people saw him as a liar, because I think it's pretty obvious to a lot of us that he's lying. But I think his supporters don't give a damn that he's lying, to be honest with you. You know, so if we go up to 60, 70% of Americans seeing, I don't know if this is going to make a difference. Oh, I'm not as optimistic, maybe, because, you know, when you read people who analyze or who have been very familiar with history, Hannah Arendt, for instance, you know, I want to quote her here, where she said, fascists don't lie simply to obscure the truth. They lie to signal what would eventually become truth once they take over. For example, throughout the campaign, throughout the Trump campaign, he spread the lie that no vetting exists for Muslims from the Middle East. You know, this is a clear and obvious lie. Anyone who's immigrated to this country can tell you about the rigorous vetting that takes place. What he actually means is all Muslims will be treated as threats. Take another example when he talks about inner city crime being at a record high. We know for a fact that this is not true. It's not at a record high. But what he wants to manifest, and which we will see probably later on in these next 4 years, is an increase in police militarization against black and brown communities and an enforcement of ever greater and more extreme laws that will not help the situation but exacerbate it even more. Keep in mind, it's a political project. And the media has been implicated in this for decades, you know, and I'm glad now, and I definitely agree that there is this sense of guilt. You're seeing a lot more alternative media getting a lot more attention. You're seeing mainstream media catching on. Maybe it's a little too late, but they're catching on, publishing stories, publishing what Muslim daily life is like, what it's like to be Muslim in America. You know, but for too long, whether it was the WMDs, whether it was, you know, these tropes about Muslims being barbaric and savage and violent, they played a part in promoting that. Now they're being eclipsed by Breitbart and these other kind of groups that have their own little bubble of social media and content consumption that is specifically geared toward those who already want to hear that, you know, confirmation bias. And I'm just wondering if we're at a point where it's too late for these mainstream media. That's just a question to put it out there. So going on, you have FBI entrapment. You know, quite often this FBI entrapment has led to the targeting of mentally disabled folks. You have the example of Rizwan Firdaus. He was targeted by FBI agents who infiltrated his mosque despite the FBI knowing that he and concluding that he had mental disabilities. The agent worked to gain the trust of Firdaus. As they grew closer, the agents convinced him to participate in a plot to blow up the Pentagon. These are people who would never have the capacity or the ability or the time, the energy, nigh impossible to commit these acts, procure any sort of, you know, what have you, weaponry. But, you know, the FBI sets up its own trap, finds people who are vulnerable, and gets them into these situations. This is something that happens again and again. You're also seeing the seizure of the assets of Muslim charities that's been going on for decades. Example, a Holy Land Foundation case. Now you have the Muslim Brotherhood Terror Bill, which Ted Cruz put in, and it's just a matter of time till Muslim organizations that have been stigmatized and associated by guilt by association as being Muslim Brotherhood front groups, this is the other trope, are going to possibly see, and the organization I work for, CAIR Chicago, see their assets frozen. We're not going to go without a fight, but this is definitely down the pipeline. So be aware, keep in mind what's going on, be involved in not allowing this to happen. You have anti-Sharia legislation, which has been going on for decades, tied often to anti-labor laws, voting rights acts. You know, 17% of Republican legislatures have sponsored anti-Sharia bills in the past. 80% sponsor by 80%, which is also tied to anti-labor. So you see an intersection of anti-Sharia laws billed as anti-foreign laws connected to other issues such as voter repression and, several other pertinent issues. You know, currently in Montana, there is a bill waiting the approval of the governor, an anti-Sharia bill, and as well as, I believe, Alabama or Georgia, where it's in the state Senate. It's not just right-wing media, I want to point out. Liberal media has been just as guilty. They're, you know, Bill Maher every week is dehumanizing Muslims, and he's doing it under the pretense of liberalism. You know, media analysis by ISPU, the Institute for Social Policy and Understanding, has shown that 80% of media coverage of Islam and Muslims is negative. So what are people going to actually think about Islam and Muslims? Lastly, yep, I just want to wrap up with this, is that, you know, the other factor here, you know, to quote Ibn Rushd, ignorance leads to fear, fear leads to hatred, and hatred leads to violence. This is the equation. It's old as time, and it's continued to happen, and let's not fall for the okey-doke. Thank you very much. I look forward to your questions.
I don't know about you all, but I have a lot on my mind now, and that was an excellent, excellent panel presentation. So one more round of applause for our great speakers. Thank you so much. So we're going to have a question and answer session right now, about 20 minutes or so. I can ask the first question to kick us off, and after that we can go from there. So this question is for all the panelists, for each of you. What ways can media influence or reinforce people's worldview? And I know you already kind of touched on that, but specifically in the time of Trump. So if anyone wants to take a go at that, feel free.
I can jump in.
There's a mic right there, yeah.
I can jump in on that really quick. So as you saw with one of the graphs I presented, Breitbart, and very much like every other media outlet out there, particularly with the with social media engagement these days and so many people getting their news from social media, it's happening in bubbles. Just think about your friend set on Facebook and think about the pages you like. Automatically, you're creating a bubble on which you're receiving your information, sharing it, and it's reinforcing a lot of those beliefs, right? And so that's why I was encouraging to kind of broaden that information base by even looking at media that you may not necessarily agree with, for example, or taking a look at Breitbart. What are they publishing? Why are they publishing it that way? And I think that will help kind of broaden your perspective and come to more of a moderate understanding, at least, of the information you're consuming.
Yeah, sure. Just to give one example that I didn't get a chance to present on, this kind of happened during the campaign, and I think it was just a very interesting scenario of how Trump, even at that time, tried to influence the media, and where some of the media, actually, particularly the local media that you were talking about, Tahera, kind of fought back. I don't know if anyone here went to the Trump rally that was held at UIC in the pavilion. I was lucky enough to get a Trump press pass. Apparently, they didn't realize who I was, but so I was there. And so the message that Trump put out was the reason that he didn't show up and talk, which he never did. There was about 3,000 protesters, and about 1,000 of them were inside the pavilion. Is that he was basically scared to show up, and he put the story out in the media that he had talked to the Chicago police, and they advised him the situation was much too dangerous. It was very violent. And then after that, there was this whole, most of the primary national media kind of repeated his story, and it became this idea that there was violence at Trump rallies. I don't know if you remember that. You know, he was above it all, and there was violence at the rallies. Well, someone was there, or anybody else, or what? There wasn't any violence. The only violence that happened was when he didn't show up, and then the Trump supporters were very angry and started fighting with some of the protesters. But the interesting thing was there were local reports, and like the local CBS and the other stations, and the Chicago Monitor did an article on it, where they quoted the police and said, no, we didn't tell Trump that. We actually said it was all fine. He was the one that chose not to show up. And then and then in our article, we talked about everything that I'm saying. So one of the things that I think is probably going to happen a little bit more, and this was kind of connecting with what you were saying, is that I think things are changing on the national level, where people are going, some of the stations, and it may be out of guilt, I don't care why, but they're questioning what Trump is doing, and you really can't get away from that, and away with that, and that's a lie. But I also think it's important that some of the local stations and local media is pushing back about local stories about what's going on. Like, think about the number of people who protested at O'Hare. I don't know if any of you at their first Muslim ban. That was huge. The number of people there, very well reported in the media. And again, that was local media, and then there was a national story. So I think some of that is changing in the local media side, and as you were saying, that there's also smaller media sources like the Chicago Monitor or The Intercept, or there's other places that are actually pushing back on this what's being presented by Trump.
Yeah, just a quick thing to offer another. I agree with what both Bill and Eamon are saying, but I think part of the problem with being in the media is it's kind of a double-edged sword, because you are, for me, I'm looking at all these issues that come up on a daily basis with what our president is saying. And you, on the one hand, you don't want to afford it more media coverage. Sometimes I just say, no, that's dumb. I don't want to report it. It's a non-issue. But at the same time, then you have this nagging feeling that everyone else is going to report it, and then you can't tell your side, or you can't offer the proper context. And if it's going to be out there, then I might as well put it in context. So I think a lot of that, and for example, it's when Trump was saying, I think right after his inauguration, he was saying how crowded it was, and he was really upset at the media for saying how empty it was, and it was a back and forth for days, and I just got so sick of it. And you know, I put it out there once, and I'm like, I'm not putting it in the show ever again. That's it. It's done. It's not important. And so I think a lot of that judgment also comes into play. And I think, as Bill was saying, that judgment is ultimately like what you guys watch every day, what most people watch is the local news. And I think if we can concentrate, maybe that's the first step. Maybe the first step is trying to influence your local news and having a good partnership and relationship with them. And then moving on to the national scene, I think one example I saw recently over the past year, and I brought this example up recently, is with Sound Vision, the Sound Vision Foundation. They put up these two billboards, one in Texas and one here, countering ISIS. It just says, ISIS, you suck. I don't know if anyone saw any of those. But it was great, and I loved it. And I saw that CNN, so we can't just report from any station, you know, we don't have an AP Wire subscription anymore, so you kind of have to wait till CNN breaks something or CBS, and then I can report it. So it's a whole, like, copyright issue. But I was really happy when CNN picked it up because I ran with it. I put it in my show. I reached out to CBS National and the kind of news director there who plugs, because I interned with them, so I still had a good relationship. And I said, hey, Dan, like, there's a billboard just like this. This was in Houston, but I know the organization that put it up. They have one in Chicago. You should check it out. Think about doing it. And I left it there. And a few days later, I see it on CBS, a whole story that the correspondent I had interned with, Dean, he sat down with Imam Abdul Malik Mujahid, who's the head of Sound Vision, and put those billboards up. And I ran the story on my show, and I was like, subhanAllah, that's like all the worlds coming together in the way that things should be working. That is a good scenario. And I try to hold on to that and say, if we can just keep engagement up like that, we can influence more than one story. So.
Okay, great. So I'll open it up. You have a question back there? I'll pass you the mic. Or, you got it.
Hi, everyone. My name is Asif. I'm a graduate student at DePaul University. And my domain does not belong to this event. It's nothing to do, but I like to read and read stuff. And I have a question. Before coming to this event, I had a question, and I decided to ask this because I'm more of a rational person. So I want to know that we talk a lot about Islamophobia and media being influencing this whole thing. I also wanted to know that at the same time, we also have an example or statistics where Islam is also the most hated religion, but also most accepted religion. Like, a lot of people are accepting it. So why, how this works, and what media is playing part in this? So I just wanted to know about this. Thank you.
I just want to point out, like, after 9/11, very interestingly enough, just in the barrage of anti-Muslim attacks, media, etc., there was a significant increase in the number of converts to Islam, speaking to what you're addressing. And also, we're seeing the same in recent years. It is the religion that most people are converting to in the United States. And I think, this is from kind of personal experience, personal opinion, really, just watching this kind of unfold over the years. I think people have grown to want to, and there are folks out there who are seeking more information on Islam. They're hearing so much about it in media that when they are exposed to it in a legitimate way, they're drawn to it. And that's my kind of understanding of it. And I think, ironically, a lot of that Islamophobia has also produced a lot of Muslims in this country.
Yeah, maybe just comment on it as a convert myself. I do think a lot of it has to do with the exposure of Islam and what Islam's all about, and certainly that increased after 9/11. I mean, if you went into a bookstore, the number of books on Islam, doubled, tripled, and so on. Now, about a third of those was, Islam's the devil, and so on. But there was a lot more information out there, and even actually, one of our good friends went to a mosque open house, which has been happening more and more often. And there's one that's out by me, Dar es Salaam, I believe. And I kind of knew it as a somewhat conservative mosque. So I was very curious how this all worked out. But It was very crowded. A lot of people from the neighborhood, and we talked to our friends, and they were very impressed with it. So some of it, I do think, has to do with, you know, what Islam is all about, and so on. And, you know, even from my perspective, you know, I grew up in the 50s in Detroit. I didn't know what Islam was. I didn't know what a Muslim was. I certainly never met one. But, you know, we've come a long way since there. The last point I want to make, though, is that whole fact that, Aymen, you were talking about, that Islam is, I think it is the fastest growing religion in the United States. Well, is that being publicized very much? No, not really. And is there a reason that's not being publicized very much? Well, it's contradictory to the message. You know, as Tauseef was talking about, well, wait a minute, if this is like the most violent religion and they're all terrorists, well, you know, that doesn't fit with the actual fact, and we get into alternative facts. Why is that the fastest growing religion in the United States? What are we all, you know, like idiots? Like, you know, well, no. So, you know, again, that's another fact that's suppressed because it doesn't fit the narrative.
Just have a small comment to make. I agree with that, with those assessments. And I think another factor that works in our favor is that there are a lot of people, a lot of American Muslims, who are stepping up to disrupt that narrative, to disrupt that message. You see, for example, Sister Linda Sarsour on the national stage. Every single national rally, she's front and center. And I think that gets people really, that jars people's stereotypes of Muslims, and especially Muslim women, like, what is this lady doing wearing her headscarf on TV, yelling into a microphone about rights for the black community and rights for women in America? And I think more of that is happening, and that's probably also why we're seeing a simultaneous rise in hate against the Muslim community, but as acceptance as well.
Yeah, I would just echo those comments. I'd be interested in looking at the polling or the research you were looking at about Muslims being accepted, or the most accepted, I forget how you termed that, but consistently there's been a lot of research over the past few years showing it to be one of the most disfavored groups. That's what we've seen in our research as well, and I do think the media has a significant part to play in the reason for that.
All right, question over there.
Assalamu alaikum, I'm Hind. So thank you all so much for the presentation. And Aymen, I'm sorry I walked in after you spoke. So perhaps you covered this, but my question to all of you is, you know, one third of the American Muslim community is African American or black, and one third of the Muslims you see on TV are not African American or black. And so what advice can you give us to sort of diversify that quote unquote Muslim voice? Or Muslim voices that you see on cable news or in print media, you know, all of the really great efforts that are coming out there to sort of talk about who American Muslims are don't seem to represent the diversity of our community.
That's a great question. I would definitely, I want to also commend you for your work as well in the Muslim ARC, Anti-Racist Collaborative. I think we have to have an internal conversation as Muslim Americans, for sure, you know, about this disparity and why it exists. Internal racism, as well as, you know, the dynamics of class within our communities. A lot of times we're not talking to one another. You know, how often are the communities who have set up the masajid, maybe within the suburbs or on the north side, communicating with those masajids which are established on the south side or the west side of Chicago? You know, quite often we're invisible to one another, and we need to break that down. I think a lot of great things are happening where, you know, these conversations do exist, but, you know, the disparity is glaring for sure.
Yeah, so I guess I'm also a plant for the Muslim Anti-Racism Collaborative. I'm also part of that organization, along with Hin. If that particular organization, one of the things that we focus on is fighting systematic racism in the Muslim community itself, and that's a major issue. And the Muslim Arc offers training and workshops and any number of things. So you could talk to Hind or myself about that. The other thing I was going to say is that some of the research that I'm doing as part of my master's degree here is really looking at Muslim Americans fighting for social justice from the whole period of the civil rights period to Black Lives Matter. And one of the things that you notice is that you hear a lot about the civil rights movement, you know, Martin Luther King, the Southern Christian Leadership Conference. Okay, well, what about particularly African-American Muslims who were very, very much a part of that movement? Well, one theory I have is the reason you don't hear about that is that for much of that time, they were not considered Muslims by the Muslim community or by the American society in general, and they were really Black Latin nationalists. So I mentioned Malcolm X earlier. You know, if you watch the Malcolm X movie, you know, most of it, he's a Black nationalist, and he kind of came to Islam at the end. No, he was part of Islam all the way through. So there is how African-American Muslims are either presented in the media, often they disappear if you watch the movies, or they're important figures, like I mentioned Amina Wadud, there's Dr. Sherman Jackson, there's any number of leaders that are African-American Muslims, you know, unless you're at American Islamic College or whatever, you might not hear very much about them. So that's an issue of racism within the Muslim community, but very importantly, it's an issue of systematic racism in the United States, and there's a particular version of that. So I think that has a lot to do with why African-American Muslims are not recognized, or their voices often are not heard.
Thanks, Bill. I would say also there are seemingly two divergent narratives taking place in the United States when it comes to American Islam. And the first Muslims in America were Black Muslims. So we think about the Black Muslim experience since, you know, coming over here in slave ships and then losing Islam because of a colonial or having religion exerted and forced upon them, another religion forced upon them. But with that said, Islam has maintained itself throughout the years, and many of the public figures we know, the most popular public figures in Islam over the course of two centuries, are Black Muslims. If you look at public figures, sports, people in sports, people in Hollywood or entertainment, many of them are African American. So I think you see that, but that's like the, you know, they're not, you know, when in sports, for example, you don't hear them described as Muslim, or that's kind of like a, you know, in the background. They're never really defined as that. So you have that one track of their, you know, there that rich history of Black Muslims in America. But then on the other end, what we're seeing in media is mostly South Asian or Arab, right? So that is the definition of a Muslim, and so that rejects that entire rich history of Black Islam and Islam in America from the get-go.
All right, a gentleman right there. Yep. His mic. The microphone.
When it comes to what you were just saying about the African-American Muslims, I want to ask you this question to all of you. Are you restricted in any way or censored or regulated in what you can put out, you know, through your vehicle that you have? Because to me, in Islam, you know, we have the Prophet, peace be upon him, we have his farewell address. And to me, in that farewell address, it stated, you know, point blank, it's not about your race, your color. It's not about the status. It's not about your kinship. So when you look at that, and work like you, the sister right there, you got a good vehicle, a very good, and you too, because you said that you didn't know anything about Muslim Islam prior to you getting some understanding. But do you think that with your platform that you have, if you're not censored, don't you think you should be using that platform a little bit better to throw that guilt off and say, look, Islam is not what I'm wearing, It's not, you know, because I'm covering up for this. And jihad, why isn't it some bodies telling it's not holy war? It means to struggle within. So that's what I'm just saying, brother right there, keep doing what you're doing, because I had no idea that infiltration was that broad of a number, because in the 60s, we were quite aware of that, but not that extent. But I commend y'all.
Any comments or notes on that?
Yeah, that's a really good point, brother. And I think you're right. We have perhaps more media agency as a Muslim American community now more than ever. And I think we aren't utilizing it to the best of our advantage. I think me as a single journalist, there's on a daily basis, it's something that's hard to think about. You're swept up in the news and all that, but it is something that needs to be on the forefront of our minds, and as Hind pointed out, it needs to be a more comprehensive approach to getting our voices out there, because we need to remember that we are a diverse community and all of our voices need to be heard. And I think so with that, as I said before, though, it does come down to our partnerships. I can't make the news. We talk about that sometimes on quote unquote slow news days, like, does someone want to go start a fire? We joke around because we have nothing, there's nothing going on. So I can't make it. But if I am presented with an opportunity to put our voices out there, I will. And I think so, it's kind of, from a journalist and viewership point of view, it's kind of meeting halfway. And Alhamdulillah, like, I have, being in the Quad Cities now for almost a year, I have established contacts in the Muslim community, and they all know from the masjid, for example, that if you have a news tip, send it to me first. So I think we need more of that. We need more engagement. If you guys know anybody in the media in your community, make sure you have a really good relationship. And you just sent, like, my roommate, for example, once, there was a slew of hate crimes at one point, and it's so sad that they all become one in our heads. But my roommate snapped me a picture from outside of one of the masjids. We have two in the Quad Cities. And somebody or multiple people have written messages of support on with chalk on our sidewalk all around the masjid. I had no idea about that. I work in the media. That's a perfect story for us to put out there. That's wonderful. But nobody told me about it. And it was so late, and I tried to get, it was on a weekend, I tried to get the weekend crew to send a reporter out there. They were short-staffed, and they couldn't get to it in time, and it rained. And we never got that story out there. I was so upset. And so I think part of it does come down to we need to all be vigilant for opportunities to get our voices out there. And if you see a good opportunity, even if, you know, just make a pitch. I think that would help.
Just one real quick thing. I have something that you could actually do and work on, and you're going to have plenty of time to do it. I don't know if many people are aware, but Malcolm X's birthday, May 19th, was made an official state of Illinois holiday last year that was passed unanimously in the Illinois House. Aymen was involved in that effort, and I was too, but more you. But anyway, no, but it's... get that word out there, and he's being celebrated as a Muslim community leader, and that's the whole point, is to do social justice work and social service work in the communities. And I think talk to your local station and build up to that, and that's going to be a really good opportunity to talk about jihad and talk about all those things that you just talked about.
All right, I think we have time for one more question. Gentleman right there.
Assalamu alaikum. My name is Arif here. I'm from Northwestern Suburban College, ex-rector. And also, I run interfaith events. But the only thing what I have seen, there are a couple of questions, why these interfaith events are not reported. And also, what is the thing that our mosque can do to invite you guys to our mosque, and you guys can be able to be part of our khutbah, like a Friday sermons, how that can be, you know, associated, because that is the what I think is that, you know, our communities are more attached, you know. This event also is not, you know, not a lot of people don't know. So how this can be, you know, achieved so that I like that you guys are doing this job, but it's not being communicated to our local mosques.
I think that's a really, really, really good question. So what I've seen, particularly post-election of Trump, is that, particularly in like local coverage, is a lot of, there are a lot of interfaith events actually happening. A lot of mosques are reaching out to the interfaith community to hold events, united in solidarity against the ban and et cetera, everything else. So media loves seeing that. And I've seen, I mean, every story you could possibly think of, I've participated in them and held these events. But as Bill was saying, for example, he gave the Malcolm X Day event that you could lead up to as a media event, right? So thinking about what, you know, what churches are around me, what synagogues, who can we connect with, how can we come together around a common cause, and we can invite the media over, and they can produce a really good story about that. And I think that's really great because more than anything right now, we all need to stand together. And I think that's a really good place to do that.
From what I understand, this is the collective's first event. So hopefully there will be many more opportunities to connect. And this is one of the ways we can do that. You know, reach out to Aymen, you know, set something up at your masjid. You know, there's a lot we can talk about in terms of what masajid can do and should be doing. You know, these are community institutions. They should be accountable to the community, right? And teaching the community. So, yeah, that's what I would want to say.
Especially, you know, if you have Sunday events, you know, that many of the masjids do, you know, invite, you know, talk to Aymen or, you know, invite one of us out to talk about some of these, you know, some of these kind of issues is really great. The other real quick example I'd give is the Jewish Voice for Peace, who I talked about a little while ago. They have a whole campaign on Islamophobia. They're just amazing. And they've had, I think, at least two huge events. I think one is Downers Grove, I think. Yeah, in Downers Grove, where they had a turnout of hundreds of people, and it was an interfaith event with, you know, the synagogue and the couple of the churches that were there and the masjid and so on, and they had speakers, and it was just a big rally, and it was covered pretty well by the media, because as Aymen said, you know, that's the kind of thing the media likes to turn out for. So those kind of events are very good too, as you know, as long as you center it around, you know, Malcolm X's birthday, or, you know, here's an interfaith event where we're going to have speakers, you know, from different groups, and absolutely invite the local media, right? They love that kind of thing. Yeah.
Real quick, we actually just in the Quad Cities, they just launched an interfaith group, and all the media stations were there. We have four different channels. So it was like one of the imams from the masjid, it was a rabbi, and it was a pastor. And they all launched a group in the face of all these rise in hate crimes. And we were all there. That is definitely true 100%. We love those stories.
All right, I'm going to close it up. So thank you all again so much for coming out. We really appreciate it. And please do check out MuslimMediaCollective.org and connect with Aymen to set up events or more programming, because I'm sure there's going to be a lot more in the future. Again, this was their first event. Again, thanks so much for coming out. And yeah, and I'll let Bill say a little bit more about AIC as well. Thank you.
Not that much more about AIC, but again, you're very welcome to come here for all of our events. We also have events throughout the year. You can get on our email list if you've left your email here. Do fill out the feedback forms. We really do take that seriously. We want to make sure that we offer good programs, and we've got a lot of good feedback. And again, if this is no heavy-duty pitch or anything. If you'd like to give a donation, that would be very much appreciated. And if you don't, that's all fine, too. Anyway, thank you very much for coming out.